On my right is Monsignor Chorbishop Beggiani. He is director of our seminary in Washington, D.C., and he celebrated his 50th anniversary as a priesthood last Thursday. And we celebrated together with him yesterday 50th anniversary of our seminary in Washington, D.C. I went to school there. George Sibali, Monsignor Kedo is an alumni. And we had, he explored our church. 72 priests graduated from the seminary under his leadership, Monsignor Beggiani. Great man, good speaker. He will be the moderator for this afternoon. And then on my right side is Bishop Hector Doueihi. You know, most of you, retired bishop of St. Mary in Brooklyn, New York. He wrote so many books and articles. I remember when he came to this country, I still have your notes. You know, he wrote them on a different color of papers because before the computer came into existence. And they were excellent. The roots of the Maronites and on Islam and other religion to the Middle East. He's very, he's a scholar. Welcome, Bishop Doueihi. Our speaker is going to go first because he travels 45 minutes from here in New Jersey. Mr. Shukri Khurshid is a franchise Northeast Division in Bellasune, Pennsylvania. Shukri is a scholar to an Islam. He will begin his remarks on Islam, and if you like to relate whatever on Christianity and Judaism to how Islam comes to truth, you're very welcome. Please welcome with me our first speaker, Shukri Khurshid.
I thought strictly I'm going to talk about interfaith, especially in Philadelphia. About 20 years ago, I came from Florida after my wife going to Temple University, and we having problem after problem in the school district between Jewish teacher and Arab student. So we were running with JCRC, Jewish Community Relations Services, and some rabbis to solve the problems day in, day out. Some in Colonial School District, we have some problems. I went with Marwan, the rabbi. And I get to know a Jewish lady by the name of, I remember her name in a second. She was working for Jewish Community Relations. To make the long story short, in 2003, they said there is a convention for interfaith in a little town called Manresa, Spain, suburb of Barcelona. So we went from Florida, from Philadelphia, four people, myself and a Jewish lady, Abby, salesman, Hockey, and two Christians. We went, we stayed 11 days in the convent, in the Catholic convent in there, and we met almost 90 different cities from all over the world about interfaith, how they do interfaith. We came back with wealth of information and said, why don't we have our interfaith in Philadelphia? So we started the interfaith of Greater Philadelphia, which means have every sect of, in Philadelphia, Christian denomination, Jewish denomination, and Muslim denominations, Buddhist, Hindus, you name it, Baha'i, all to be on one table to discuss Philadelphia issues. So we started the organization. I was one of those people who found it. And then from that, we start to communicate with each other. With that, we come something called the Religious Leader Council, which is part of the mayor action now. In other words, from every denomination, we have a member who is on that committee. And if there is any crisis in the city, we immediately we call each other rather than to let the problem go out of hand. Like the police the other day went to a mosque looking for a thief. People were up in arms on one phone call for Michael Byrd, the one Father Paul invite. Michael Byrd, he is the coordinator for the interfaith of the city of Philadelphia. One phone call, he said, the deputy commissioner to go there and solve the problem. Also, I learned I was appointed by the mayor to be the human relations commissioner. And this is what's so great about this country. We have a golden opportunity to teach your children in this country. What we can do here, we cannot even do back home. And I'm originally from Damascus, Syria. What we can do here, we cannot do back home. Not in Lebanon, not in Syria, not anywhere else. So we can save our identity, but at the same time, you can live together. So when I practice to be the commissioner of the human relation, I get every month between 22 to 25 cases of discrimination. And I have to rule on them. And that teach you not to discriminate against religion, color, race, national origin, etc. And that's another opportunity to teach us how to be a positive movement inside this country, because we get the opportunity to do that. I have a complex called conference, because every conference I go to, the speech, the speaker, he goes for 45 minutes and never have time for a questioning. And every time when they finish, said, I'm sorry, we don't have time for the questioning. And I know people always have questions. This is why I always like to have my speech very short, and I leave the floor for switching. And please don't feel offended me, because I do that all the time to all denomination. If you have any question in your mind you're always shy to ask, just use this opportunity to ask it. You will not offend nobody, because we do need to sit on the same table to progress in this country like we do. We didn't get that chance back home. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The theme of our panel today is identity and evangelization. And certainly part of evangelization, even for Christians, is to share what they have and not so much be in competition with another religion, let alone try to be judgmental about other religions. And so I'm very happy to see what you've initiated. And so I think that that's very fitting that you would present your view here, and certainly for all religions, even after all these thousands of years in some cases, we're still trying to feel out how we can relate to each other in a way that is humane, in a way that reflects universal values.
Absolutely. I just have an experience having one time in synagogue. I was invited to dinner in a synagogue. When I was sitting on the table, there were little things written in Hebrew, which I didn't need to read Hebrew. So I asked, what is that? He said, this is something we repeat when we eat. And when they translated to me, it actually was Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, the name of God, the most merciful, the compassionate. Let's tell you how we are all come from one Lord, and it's stupid for us not to sit and talk. And I had also another lecture the other day, people coming from Bosnia, from all kinds of denominations. And they want me to speak on their behalf, and they were some tense in the room. I said, what other option do we have but to shake our hand to work together? Look at America. Everybody is here, and we don't fight. We work with everybody. So why don't you take that example back home? Because there is no inter-civil war or any other conflict except to shake hands and work together to build. What's happening in the Arab world, because we are selfish. I have, you don't. And I don't care what you feel about it. You go, I went 2 years in Germany, then I came here for 40 years. I haven't seen difference between countryside and big city. I see there is all, there is services, there is electricity, there is street, there is decent school in every village. This is not the same back home. Back home, the village been neglected. Minority been neglected. Whoever in the power, that's all I want to have. I'm not talking about Alawi such or Christian such or any other denomination, but whoever in power take everything to his side. When Saddam Hussein was in Iraq, he took everything and he was called his Sunni, he killed Shiites. And before Hafez al-Assad, every group came in, they killed the Durzi. Adib Shishakli killed the Durzi. We need to learn from this country. We can live all as minority. I'm Cherkasy myself. I'm Circassian by myself. Syria was welcoming every immigrant. I mean, my grandfather came from Russia, been massacred, $10 a piece, put him on a boat, ship him to Syria, Lebanon, Jordan, or dump him in the Mediterranean Sea, go for more. History is black, but we need to learn as Arab American to take this. When I went to Syria in the summer a few years back, I keep telling them why the countryside is not like the city. I mean, you have what it takes. I mean, we have the resources. So there is unfair and injustice in there, in the whole Arab world. And that's what needs to be changed. This is what I see as Jones.
Okay.
I met with almost 80 children, Arab students, in one school, Northeast High. And I said, they were watching the news the day before, they see what happened in Palestine, they came, one of them, they hit the teacher, took his kamacha out of his head, and I said, when I was in college, 1973, in Florida, and we have the war in the Middle East, when we had the tension in the classroom and almost we were going to have problem with the Jewish kids. I was in Florida and most of Floridians are either Cuban or Jewish. The teacher said to me, I will never forget him, he said, Shukri, 25 years ago, black and Jewish, they could not live in certain area in Florida. They have sign, no black, no Jewish. Look what happened to the Jewish today. So I was telling the student, you are not going to be hero by hitting your teacher. You're going to be hero by making straight A's. And you go to college and make straight A's and be attorney and defend us. Now I am with the AAI, which our leader is Jim Zogby, which he is a Christian, but Jim Zogby understood the culture, what we need to do in America. This is why our children is very important to understand the identity and not to forget Lebanon, not to forget Syria, but at the same time, you are a good messenger here to do something for your community. So yes, it did more by one-on-one, by talking to the children, said, you can't succeed by hitting your teacher. You can succeed only by being a straight A student.
Personally, I was very impressed by what Mr. Shukri was telling us. His spirit is a spirit of conciliation, of communication, and that's all what we need. If we know how to pass it to our children, to our new generation, it will help to come to a sit together and keep doing the good work.
Thank you very much. I appreciate your presentation. I want to get back to my situation here as chairman of the Commission for Lebanon for the Eparchy of St. Marin, but also Father Abdullah Zaidan couldn't be here for the Eparchy of Our Lady of Lebanon, and he asked me to represent him. And so I want to follow up now on the theme of identity and evangelization. And again, as I do every year, I want to remind all of us what the Commission for Lebanon was about. I believe we started in 1985. And we started because at that time, as all of us here know, the situation in Lebanon was very drastic. And we wanted to have some kind of unified church group that would represent the Maronites in Lebanon here in the United States. And so we really had, I think, four purposes. The first purpose, which was very important, was to educate our own people as to what was at stake in Lebanon from a church point of view. The second was to lobby with the American Catholic Church regarding Lebanon, which we have done. The third was to lobby with the U.S. government, whether it be in Congress or in the State Department and sometimes in the White House, as to what we can do to help Lebanon. The fourth was at that time to raise funds as much as we could for charitable purposes, which we were able to do, at least in the first couple of years, we raised $200,000, which at that time for us as a small group was very good, with the help of the American parishes here. So this has been our mission. Now, as all of you know, in the last few years, Things have changed a lot. And I must be honest with you, and those of you who have been here before with me, you know I tell it as it is. And sometimes I'm accused of siding with one party over another. No, I don't. In fact, I think most parties are crazy. But Bishop Rye some weeks ago talked about the silent majority in Lebanon. I think there is a silent majority who's had a lot of problems with what's going on. But I must say, in the last few years, I didn't go to Congress because what am I to tell them? Who do I represent? What do I want to ask for Lebanon? And can I ask for help for Lebanon when a significant group over there is saying the Americans are Zionists and the enemy? If I went there and tried to present Lebanon, I'd get some questions, even from the chairman of the committee now, and I wonder what she would ask me. And so to be honest with you, things have changed a lot. But what's at stake today in Lebanon for the Christians and for Maronites is even more critical than before. More critical than before. When we had the war in Lebanon, you knew who was on which side. And at least at that time, although of course it was drastic, you knew what you had to stand for and what you had to defend. But now we're in a different situation in Lebanon for the Christians, where we're really dealing on the level of ideology, and we're dealing on the level of national policy. And if we're not careful, then the Christians will be the losers. And so on my position, and those of you who know me, from the first day I've been chairman of the commission, my concern is the Christians and the Maronites. It's not, who gains what over whom. Now, regarding what I want to present to you today, and I won't speak that long, and I'm glad to have Bishop Doueihi with me because I respect so much his views. But what I want to speak to you today, and I gave a similar talk in Washington, D.C. a couple months ago, is regarding certainly the idea of identity, but regarding what it is that Christians represent in Lebanon. And you heard me the last 2 years, I'm very bothered as an American when we say that Lebanon is an Arab country. And as you heard me say the last few years, nobody ever deconstructs the term Arab. What does it mean to say you're an Arab country? Does it mean you're a member of the Arab League? Does it mean that you speak Arabic? Does it mean that you are, under the Arabic of the Quran, that you're a Muslim country? What does it mean to say that Lebanon is an Arab country? And it's in the national pact, the original national pact. It's in the Taif Accord. But it seems that people, we Lebanese are very good at this, we use words that are vague enough that anybody can read into it what they want to. And if you get too close to the truth, they say, I didn't mean that. But my argument here is that as soon as you say an Arab country, we're already disadvantaged. We don't say the United States is an English country, although we speak English. And so in the last several months, I've been thinking about the fact that we Maronites and we Christians in Lebanon, I think, have given too much of a narrow presentation of who we are, identity-wise. By that I mean, certainly, much of what we are, we find in the liturgy. We find in the way we pray and in the way we worship. And that is central to who we are. And I think Bishop Doueihi is going to make some comments about that. But please remember, if you study world religions, if you study world cultures, religion is an expression of culture. And a religion, faith, even the Christian faith, comes out of a cultural expression, and the Christian faith itself develops the culture.
And so we're not just people who go to church on Sunday and pray. We are people who represent a rich culture. And it's true when we say that we of the Maronite Church represents Syriac Christianity. Syriac Christianity. We are representative of it. There are others who are representative of it. The Syrian Catholic Church, the Syrian Orthodox Church, the Malankar Church, the Malabar Church to a degree. They're also affected by the Indian culture. But we represent, in a sense, in its pure form, Syriac Christianity. Now, what does that mean? Well, certainly our ancestors spoke Syriac. Our liturgy, our worship was in Syriac. But even here, a language is an expression of a worldview, a culture. And what most of us don't know is that, you know, we always brag about the fact that we speak Aramaic,